Hello, everyone. I'm Robert Winter, and welcome to another lesson with Music in the Air. MITA is a desktop application where you can learn about music in interactive ways you never imagined. We're going to use it today to introduce ourselves to the West and the musical frame. You can subscribe quickly and easily to MITA at our website, getmita.com. Frame, of course, means a number of things. She framed her arguments so eloquently, or he was unjustly framed for a murder when he was 600 miles away, or where did you find that frame for your granddaughter's iPhone photo? You've probably heard a lot less about musical frames, not the least because no one seems very interested in talking about it. Before we dive in, I want to be clear that the art I show you and the music we're going to listen to today are in no way comprehensive. But they will, I hope, offer you a fresh way of thinking about Western music over about a 900-year span. I'll talk more about what I think it means as we move through the centuries. We'll first begin with a piece of Chinese art from the 12th, 13th century. This is Loquats and a Mountain Bird by an anonymous painter of the Southern Song Dynasty. This was about the 13th century. These kind of small album leaf paintings were very popular among scholars and officials. Notice there is no frame. This is actually painted on silk and would have been part of an album. Next, let's take a look at a fan painting. These paintings are a perfect example of borderless art because the design on the fan literally has no borders as it flies back and forth in the air. Now I'd like to look at two very different pieces of art. The first one, one of the many, many, the Enlightenment of the Buddhas that you will find in Buddhist art, the Enlightenment of Sakyamuni here. This is from the late 12th century. And this piece of art here, which is the Virgin and Child enthroned between angels. And if you look at the two of them, they have obvious similarities. We have the Virgin Mary here in the center with the halo around her. She's clearly now the mother of Christ. And we have then the figure of the Buddha here. He is surrounded also by many followers. But if you look a little bit more closely, the borders in this Buddhist art are much less clearly defined. You could imagine this space extending up and down, whereas the borders in this church in Ravenna, Italy, this mosaic dates back to the middle of the 6th century, is very clearly defined all the way around. And the angels' wings themselves even seem to have rather clearly defined borders. And these figures are much more clearly defined than they are in the Buddhist art. So you have a space here, which is dedicated to a specific task. So let's look now briefly at a piece of art that very clearly involves a frame. Western art started using frames in the late 11th, 12th century. This is probably from about the 12th century. And you'll notice if you look carefully at the frame, it was once a single piece of wood that was actually carved out so that you had the space to do the painting inside of it. This, of course, makes the frame a dominant feature of this particular kind of art. Most art till this point is on altarpieces or within churches. It's not hanging in homes or in galleries, obviously. So this particular picture of, again, Mary with child, she is right at the center of this. And the frame shows us that this is the thing we want to focus on. Well, let's look now at a piece of music from roughly the same period. This is an absolutely beautiful piece of plain chant. It's often called Gregorian chant, although Pope Gregory probably didn't compose any plain chant, as it were, but it simply meant music in one voice. This is an absolutely gorgeous Marian antiphon called Alma Redemptoris Mater, or Loving Mother of the Redeemer. And it doesn't matter if you don't read music at all, because I'm going to point out that this note here, which is on the second line from the top, you can certainly remember that. And if you follow each of the lines that define this chant, which only lasts about 90 seconds, it begins and ends on that same note. And actually, it goes up exactly one octave here before descending. And here it goes on the note five notes above and descends down to the note three notes above. These are the only three notes that begin or end lines. So that note, yum, called the finale. And by the way, if you have perfect pitch, they're not singing on F here. They're singing on a D flat, actually. But it doesn't matter that they sing on a different pitch because the mode here was known as Lydian. This is Lydian beginning and ending on F, Lydian with a B flat. And you might say, that looks a lot. I took piano lessons. That's like a major scale, isn't it? Well, in one sense, yes, but it doesn't function in any way like a major scale. It has its own rules of melodic shape and profile, which we'll see in just a moment. So let's start here and see how this first line then begins and ends on this finale, the final note. Not the same as a modern tonic, because it was a much less emphatic place of departure and arrival, but it was the home nonetheless. Here we go. And you'll see that the place that they stopped at the end of the first phrase was the A, two notes, or a third, above the F, and then they went to the C here. So these three notes, yum, bum, bum, are the governing notes of this mode, and all of the lines begin or end on it. I also want to point out here the first instance of a formula, a melodic formula that gets used four times in the course of this chant. What it does, it's a microcosm of this frame. It begins on the finale here, rises up to the A, and descends back. So it sounds like this. So this expanded instance of the formula down here in section two, it goes up a note higher to the B flat, but it does the same thing. Begins on the F, rises, and descends back to it. Let's hear it. So these sections, and there are essentially four small sections, they flow right one into the other, but they all do the same kind of thing in varied fashion. Here we have the higher octave F descending back to the original F, and then an even more expanded use of the formula where the F goes up and has more notes in the figure and then descends back to the F. Let's listen to that. And sometimes the descent from the upper F to the lower F is much quicker, as here in the fourth section. And all of this sets up the final line on that greeting, Ave, have mercy on us sinners. It will begin on the F, rise, and descend to the F. And then it will have that formula that we began with at the end, which is a kind of miniature of this whole line. And this final note then constitutes the end of the piece and the clear delineation of the frame. So it's gentle and very devotional, but there's no question about the sense of the frame on either side. Let's move now from the 11th century to mid-14th century France and the extraordinary period of the great poet, composer, Guillaume de Machaut. For 37 years, he lived and worked in this cathedral where he didn't have a whole lot of duties and was free to be one of the great poets, the great poet of 14th century France. Some of his poems, which were narrative in nature, ran to 10,000 lines. He also wrote a fair amount of music to go with those poems. This piece of his, known as the Mass of Notre Dame, before we look at it, I want to just show a couple of pieces of Western art on either side. Here's one from the 13th century. And you'll notice this pair of Morris singers is part of a medieval songbook. It doesn't need a frame, but it has one nonetheless. And you'll notice that the players, in fact, are standing on the frame. And then on the other side, here's a portrait from about 1470 by the Italian painter Antonello da Messina. And you'll notice that the frame is a crucial part of bringing our attention to the light of the face here. The frame really sets it off, and the colors in the hair, the facial tones, all blend in with the frame around it. So with that in mind, let's take a look now at this Mass of Notre Dame by Guillaume de Machaut. This Gloria is one of the five movements that belong to the so-called Mass Ordinary. These are the sections of the Mass that occur weekly. Machaut is writing in the so-called Dorian mode here. It's built on D, D, E, F, G, A, and so forth, but it has a peculiar characteristic, and that is that it has what we would call today a leading tone, and you'll hear how it works in just a moment. It'll sound really funky to you, but that's perfectly okay. So he's going to begin on these open fifths of D and A. It's a sound that will anchor the beginning and we'll see anchor the end of the movement. So here's how it begins. This is really a highly individual language. These particular arrangement here of C sharp, these are notes only a half step directly below the D of the final of that Dorian mode. And it's called often a double leading tone cadence because you have the leading tone here, the seventh degree, and the seventh degree also here. And then in between, you have other notes of the triad. So this kind of very clear Dorian beginning, composers began looking for more and more emphatic ways of concluding these movements. And so one of the ways was by using liturgy that ended with Amen. We think of Amen as being so closely associated with Christianity, but it actually comes from the Hebrew Bible, the Jewish Bible. It really means, in a sense, so be it, truly. It's an affirmation. And it is a fairly short one in the liturgy. It's two syllables. But composers began to stretch it out. If you just look at these pages, on one syllable, ah, they're singing ah, 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 ah. And finally, on the last note here, they go to men. So another technique they use to make this interesting, and it really is something that you probably haven't heard before, it's called hocket. And what it simply means is that the melody jumps from this upper voice to the voice below it, the altus, to this voice, and then back up here, and then down here, and then back up here. It gets very animated over here as these faster notes take over in the lowest voice. It's really a wonderful finish. So let's listen to this Amen from the Gloria to Machaut's Mass. Those are the very same fifths, the Dorian mode that we began the movement on, and it's underscored by this wonderful double leading tone cadence. Listen once more. That'll stay in your mind. So before we leave 14th century France, I'd like to jump back to the first half of the 12th century in central China to a wonderful painting by Zhang Ziduan, who was part of the Northern Song Dynasty. This is called Along the River During the Qingming Festival. This is a very special festival in China, known in English today as Tomb Sweeping Festival. And it is a time when families all get together and they then go to the tombs of their ancestors. They clean them, they sweep them, of course. They maybe bring flowers. They spend time thinking about the great debt that they owe their ancestors. So this is quite a wonderful painting. This could be an imperial residence, but actually it's a little bit wider than that. So I'm going to take us slowly on a tour along the river. And there you see bridges and various structures, lots of people, homes. My goodness, when will this end? Another bridge over the river. Will it ever end? Oh my gosh, it's finally ended. So this is one long scroll, but actually that was only half of it. Here's the other half. And it includes my favorite bridge of all coming up here. Makes the Brooklyn Bridge look like small beans, doesn't it? I mean, continue to move along. You'll be happy to know that the entire painted scroll contains 814 humans, 170 trees, 60 animals, 30 buildings, 28 boats, 20 vehicles, not to mention the 8 sedan chairs. Now, this seal up here actually belongs to an 18th century emperor, Qianlong, and clearly he valued this scroll greatly, and it is today kept in the Central Museum in Beijing. It's only shown every couple of years. But what a glorious piece. It's more than 17 feet long and 10 inches high. Imagine getting all this extraordinary detail. But of course, what a scroll doesn't have is a frame. And you can imagine that the nature shown throughout here extends above and below the painting. There's no attempt to feel its constraint. And in fact, we're encouraged to think of it as extending out in both directions. Okay, let's get back now and move to the era of the triad. A triad is simply three notes that are each a third apart. So if we take this note as the bottom note of the triad here, yum, well then the third would be yum, and the fifth would be yum, yum pum pum. And we're going to hear a lot of these triads as part of the harmonies all the way through this piece. It's going to conclude phrases on triads and will end on a full triad. This is also the beginning of polyphony, where we have a discernible melody, right? Mein Trost ob allen Weiben, thine, and so forth. You'll hear that melody on the top. It will be then supported by the voices below. Notice again, this is the same F that we had in the Marian antiphon. But if we then go through, we'll see that there are intermediate cadences on other notes. This is the note below the F and the note just above it. But if we keep moving, here we go back to that main note, that Lydian finale, and we conclude with what some would call today a dominant Teutonic cadence. That would have been foreign language to Heinrich Isaac, the Flemish German-speaking composer who wrote this wonderful Lied, as it was called, or song. You'll see just how it works to give a wonderful sense of frame on both sides. And you will hear the small group of singers accompanied by a lute.
Mein Trost ob allen Weiben.
preserve your virtue. This is a song sung by a man who is having to leave Innsbruck, his hometown, and he has a beloved there. And composers were very sensitive to their texts, so although the translation here says, until I come again, it actually in German says, until I again, and then on the next page, come. And that is because again is going to be a long time away. And that's why it gets this, what's called a long melisma, much like we had in the earlier Marian antiphon. And now simply we repeat this cadence to drive home this sense of a concluding frame. So that's a really strong cadence, even though it's sung very gently. Again, another kind of frame that affirms the new importance of the triad. Well, if we just jump until the mid-latter part of the 16th century, here is the only authentic image from the time of Palestrina, the composer. Here he is presenting, this is part of a music publication, a set of masses to Pope Julius III. Now, is this an accurate physical likeness of Palestrina? And did the Pope sit there with his hand held up for the engraver? Probably not, but this is the only thing we have to go on. But of course, everyone wants to know, well, what did he really look like? So bring in the GQ cover painters. This could go on the cover of any 16th century gentleman's quarterly. You might say, well, I see some resemblance between those two. But obviously it's been filled out a lot, and this is not authentic in any way of the composer Giovanni Pierluigi da Palestrina. He had an extraordinary life that we don't have time to go into, but nonetheless, by the end of the 16th century, he was revered for his mastery of what was called the perfect polyphonic art, and that is an art form in which the voices are perfectly regulated. The dissonances all occur on weak beats, for example, and the consonances all on strong beats, and the cadences are spread out exactly to underscore the flow of the text. And you sometimes have, as at the beginning here, four parts singing, and then you switch to these four voices singing. This perfect sense of balance and equilibrium, and it is saturated now with triads. We heard a good number of triads in the Heinrich Isaac lead we just listened to, but here it is from beginning to end, governed by triads. So here we begin on, it looks like a G major chord. I will warn you in advance, if you have perfect pitch, they're singing an F, it doesn't matter. This is what would have been known basically as the Mixolydian and sometimes Ionian, because we're going to see where it goes, mode. Again, the extraordinary sensitivity to the words on the text visibilium, which means things that are visible, and then et invisibilium, things that are not visible. So we rise on the visible things and we descend on the invisible things. I want want you to remember this moment right here, where the soprano rises to the third of a C major triad. This is going to be exactly how the movement ends. But in an even more dramatic fashion. The sonority with which this credo, this is the third of the five movements of the Mass Ordinary, and it's a long recitation of the doctrinal beliefs of the church. It ends with this cascade on guess what word again, on the word amen. But it will end on a sonority, not the G that we began with, but will end on a closely related sonority in C. This particular relationship, beginning on G, ending on C, is how most every movement in the Mass is structured. So there is a kind of unity among the movements themselves. You'll remember, of course, the Hockett ending of the Machaut Mass, in which a bit of pandemonium, delicious pandemonium. So what are all these arrows in this amen? Well, the downward arrows simply show that the musical lines are all cascading downwards like a waterfall. And then these lines that go up vertically point out what's called imitation. This begins here, and then this begins shortly thereafter and does exactly the same thing as this does. So you have this imitative waterfall, if you will, to the end. Let's take a listen. Opening sonority, the third was also in the soprano. If you think of how triads work, it is that middle note which decides whether it's major or minor. It gives the color to that sonority. And when you put it in the soprano, you emphasize the sensual nature of the triad. Now you'll notice there's also a feature here called contrary motion. Contrary motion really goes back to the earliest polyphonic times in the 10th, 11th centuries. But here it is used in a very systematic way to tell us that the movement is over. So we have all these cascades down, and then at the end here, the soprano goes up all the way from the G to the E. Listen once more and focus on how this line goes up, all the other lines go down. That gives us a sort of finality, because these are independent voices that are finding their final place of repose or rest. Now you may be thinking, frames, I hear them, I dig it. But what's the significance? What does it mean? Well, let's explore this just for a moment before we go on. A frame around something can be interpreted as a way of controlling the art, controlling the language. If you have a clear beginning and a clear, bounded ending, and this is characteristic of Western music from its very inception, it is a sense that other cultures didn't feel the need for, as we've seen in that extraordinary piece of Chinese scroll art. They are boundless in that sense. That is, they go off into infinity. There's no sense of this is proprietary in any way. You may have heard of the 15th century Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama, who wended his way down the western coast of Africa, finally around the southern tip, all the way up around the east coast, and found his way to India, where he undertook trade on behalf of the queen and king of Portugal. He was a ruthless human being, in short. One verified historical incident, he came across a boat of 400 Muslim pilgrims, and they offered all kinds of booty and ransom in order not to be burned, but he decided, no, he didn't want their money. He would burn them anyway. So he set the boat afire and went off a safe distance away and watched while it burned amid the screaming of all the children and women and men and watched it sink. So the West, we have to say, not only then wanted a musical language that it could control within these frames, but it wanted to control other parts of the world. And one thing that sets the European experience apart from virtually all others in the world, and it's not that the West were the only people who undertook military operations against other groups, but it was the extraordinarily systematic way in which the Portuguese and then the Spanish and then the Italians, when the English finally began circumnavigating the globe and planting flags and saying, this now belongs to us. It is that moment in 1492 when Christopher Columbus sets on land somewhere in the Bahamas, and 100 years later, about 10% of the roughly 75 million indigenous peoples that were there when he landed have survived. So this is a double-edged sword. I'll say more about that in a little bit. But for now, let's move from Palestrina briefly to another Chinese painting without a frame, Su Wu. This is from the early 3rd century, this story. This gentleman was sent from the capital to be an ambassador somewhere in probably Inner Mongolia. But they kept him for 19 years and did not allow him to return home, even though he was only supposed to have gone for a year or two. So instead of becoming bitter or angry or organizing military forces, he became a simple shepherd here. And you can see that extraordinary look of steadfastness on his face. And there are his loyal goats next to him. But you'll notice again, the most important thing, there is no border. So let's jump now to something a little more Western. That is this wonderful caricature of the 18th century composer Antonio Vivaldi, who was roughly a contemporary of Bach and Handel and Rameau. This is a picture that doesn't really need a frame particularly, because it's just an ink drawing. And it says, the Red Priest, composer of music who made the opera at the Capranica, that's a town near Rome, in 1723. And this nose was not considered a character at all. It was a sign of great creative power. So we've seen then how in the Palestrina, the beautiful saturated triad creates the sense of frame. Let's look at how it works now in these works by Vivaldi that are known as ritornello forms. Now, what is a ritornello? Well, the Italian word ritorno means to return. And so ello is the diminutive form of words in Italian. So therefore, ritornello means simply the little thing that returns. And that's exactly what frames this movement that will be very familiar to you, the first movement of Autumn from the Four Seasons by Vivaldi. And listen to how it uses repetition and a forceful cadence on the tonic, triad on the tonic note to make this initial frame. Now you'll notice it's only this cadence that returns back to the tonic note. This structure, by the way, is so familiar in the West. We'll talk more about this in another lesson, but it is A, we like that A, so play it again for me. So I'll play it again for you. But now I don't want to hear it a third time. Give me some variety. Okay, there it is. But now maybe round it out with some version of that thing you played me the first time. And that's exactly how that frame works. Listen again. This ritornello is now cast in a new system that we call today triadic tonality. You'll be familiar from just hearing it probably much of your lives. The Italians were essentially the chief architects of this new system. It's also a system of control, which we'll talk about in another lesson. But this structure here is, again, very sturdy. We have this opening ritornello, then the soloist plays. Let's just hear one of Vivaldi's solo episodes, as they were called. Wow, fistfuls of notes. Well, Vivaldi wrote these parts for himself. He was a very accomplished violinist, and he traveled across Europe, putting on concerts from which he made very, very tidy profits. So this ritornello, though, does come back from time to time. For example, here it is, softly and in G minor, but it's still clearly the ritornello. And then again, it will come back in a more strong and forceful fashion here in C major. But you'll notice that the original ritornello has not returned. That's because it's going to frame the movement. So if we go here then, this will now be, you can see the tempo is called allegro assai. It's faster than the first section. And it's going to be a compressed version of that opening ritornello. Notice it's not going to repeat these opening three bars called the A phrases. It's going to go right to B, but it will clearly be a frame, a sturdy frame that lasts about 15, 20 seconds of the entire movement. So there, right? Okay, now we are going to jump to a great contemporary of Vivaldi's, Johann Sebastian Bach. Bach, as it turns out, was a great fan of Vivaldi's, and we don't know exactly how he got parts and scores, but he managed to get a hold of them, and he really integrated it into his overall style, which he had a great gift for doing. This is actually, this picture isn't a frame if you've ever seen the original. This is the only portrait we have of Bach. It's kind of disappointingly impersonal in a way. And probably this hand and maybe even the coat and these things were part of a stock way of drawing. This is a canon that Bach composed, but it's the only likeness from his time that we have. So to illustrate Bach's use of the frame, we're going to look at a piece that's in what's called da capo form. And that is, this piece only has three sections, an opening A section that will begin on its tonic and end on its tonic, that was called the tonic. The B section will be largely in the minor mode because we now talk about the sick and the wayward who raise their voices to ask for help. And as we get them to text your blessed images to us, a source of joy, we move back to the major mode and we cadence on what was called the dominant or the key very, very close. We simply have da capo. Da capo is Italian for the head. Go back to the head or the beginning of the piece. And that's exactly how this works. And what could be a sturdier frame? It's like two granite blocks with contrasting material in between. It couldn't be more solid. But the ritornello notion is still here nonetheless. And you'll hear as the organ plays this joyous instrumental ritornello. And I just want to tell you straight up that the wonderful melody that the organist plays here is not one that Bach wrote, but one that the organist came up with on her or his own. So this is a duet sung by the soprano and the alto, and they really represent the wayward sinner reaching out to Jesus. Those are the two people, but it is in the form of an Italian love duet. This could easily have come from an opera where da capo arias were the structural pillar. So here we go with this wonderfully imitative, and you'll notice that when we get over here, they'll sing in parallel thirds and sixths, which were the indelible markers of love in Western music no later than the 16th century. Oh, You know, people think of Bach as very serious and earnest and a bit dour, perhaps, but he could express joy in music in a thousand ways, and this is just one of his more delicious examples. Notice they sang back and forth to each other. We call that antiphonally, and now the parallel thirds and sixths. So how will this A section end then? Well, it will be framed once again by guess what? Notice that wonderful trill that the organist put up in the very top. That was, again, the organist's choice. So there's that pillar. We go immediately to the minor mode. There's no what we often call in triadic tonality, a pivot chord, a kind of transitional chord that facilitates, leads the way to the next key. No, we jump right from this cadence here into G minor. And then when we get to the end of the section, we are going to have set up the return to B flat and with a little bit of parallel thirds and sixths to anticipate. Da capo. Now this entire A section is repeated. Baroque singers often embellish the returns, but the music is essentially exactly the same as it was the first time. So you have these massive pillars. And if you think about Baroque art, if you've gone into the Metropolitan Museum in New York or other places, and you go into those spaces, my God, these rooms, these paintings are like 30 feet wide and 10 feet tall. They're taller than, bigger than we are. Well, that is, again, this kind of structure of da capo form. It's very sturdy. This was the age, after all, of absolutism, of kings who wanted control in a major fashion. It couldn't be more clear-cut than this kind of musical form. Now we're going to make a big jump up to Beethoven, but I want to do that with two images. One from India in the early part of the 18th century, a lady playing the tanpura. This is an instrument somewhat like the sitar, which is a larger version of this. And this is, again, from the Rajasthan courts. It's a beautiful picture, and it's interesting, particularly because women were frowned upon who took part in music making. It was considered the profession then of a courtesan or even perhaps a prostitute. They were looked down upon, but this is a beautiful, sensitive painting of a female tanpura player. But notice again, it has a piece of paper on which this work was created, and then it's set into some background, stronger paper to keep it straight. But notice that that paper that they chose has exactly the same color as the gourd or bowl of the tanpura. So it is not a border that draws attention to itself and says, this is a confined space. No, it's again, a very open-ended kind of treatment. While we're on this image, it would be a perfect time for me to underscore the fact that although we're focusing today on the West and the musical frame, this in no way suggests that all the other extraordinary varieties of music across the globe are somehow missing out on something. Far from it. The Hindustani North Indian tradition from which this image comes is rich and complex and nuanced and subtle in extraordinary ways. An example would be the raga. A raga is not a composition. It's really an experience, a shared experience that the performers bring to us. Typically, it would begin with an alap, an introduction that would explore the aspects of the raga that will be more fully developed later. But an alap itself might take 50 minutes. When the tabla finally enters and we go into the more central part of the raga, it could last 20 minutes, it could last 40 minutes, it could last 2 hours. And so the performance of a raga simply doesn't need the kind of frame, that the West came to rely on. And this enormous diversity across the globe is something that should be a great cause for celebration. Okay, moving back to images now. This extraordinary portrait of the Countess of Chartres by the very talented painter Elizabeth Lebrun in 1789 offers a textbook example of how central the frame had become to Western art. Look at the color scheme here. The gold of the frame is reinforced by the gold inside the painting. The black sash, the black hat, all reinforced by the black background around the edges of the frame, the black Bible. All of these serve to highlight the flowing white material of this extraordinary dress. And to be sure, she's holding a Bible. But everything about the frame draws our attention to this face in the middle, which to be sure looks out at us quite impassively. With that bit of background, I'd like to spend just a little bit of time, not on the Beethoven Fifth Symphony, which we'll do another time, but on the extraordinary first movement of the Fourth Piano Concerto. Composed when Beethoven was in his mid-30s, he was now well-established as part of what scholars often refer to as Beethoven's heroic decade. A lot of the pieces that you know and love, the Eroica Symphony, the Seventh Symphony, the Third, Fourth, and Fifth Piano Concertos, and so forth, were all written during this period. Journey a number of times from a contemplative mood to a heroic one. We're going to see this now in miniature at the very beginning of what's called the opening ritornello. Again, notice that this notion of ritornello was incorporated by German composers. Actually, Mozart was the one who invented this into the concerto model, so that you have some aspects of it still that are being combined then with what we call the more dynamic sonata form. So here's the opening, played by the great Alfred Brendel. My God, what is that chord? Where did it come from? It completely derails this gentle opening. And we know that Beethoven loved conflict, loved working one's way back from adversity, even if it's very soft and hushed. So listen how he then builds from this momentary side trip, going off the road perhaps for a bit, and builds his way back to this heroic mood. Back in G major now. I want you to listen to that chord for a moment. It's now fortissimo and heroic. But it's exactly the same chord that we heard at the opening. And with the third in the soprano that we've seen numerous times today. So the contemplative opening and the heroic climax. But I wanted just to point out that Beethoven really does get lost. We're in G major, and he finds himself suddenly in C sharp minor. This is the furthest away. It's like, how closely am I related to a snail would be a good way of thinking how far away he is in terms of the key relationship. And we have to find our way back from utter stillness and desolation. Thank you. And of course, he will work his way back. The way in which this is framed is a whole new level of this emphatic conclusion, with this heroic stance, if you will. So we're now going to do this, though, going from, again, the contemplative to the heroic. And you'll see that the soloist actually now is the assertive one who takes the lead and makes this final framing statement. And now this cascade of very fast, short notes, pianissimo, will lead to this extraordinary buildup. And by the way, you're hearing that rhythm. Bop, 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 bum. Isn't that the Fifth Symphony? Da, 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 dum. Yeah, it is, but this was written first. Okay. You'll notice at the very end here, the soloist was playing these parallel arpeggios. But at the very last moment, the soloist too embarks on contrary motion, which is his or her way of putting a final stamp. See if you can hear it. Now, I want to get back just for a moment to considering what all this might mean. You know, we had the Portuguese and then the Spanish and then the Italians and the English kind of going around and colonizing lots of parts of the world. And it reached something of a climax at the end of the 19th century when the Prussian Emperor Bismarck called together, particularly the French and the Germans and the Italians, wanted to make sure that they didn't fight over the same piece of Africa. What a waste that would be. So why don't we, and this looks like a big cheese plate, but that's in fact exactly what all these countries did in this 1884 conference. They literally carved up Africa just like this. And look at all these pieces. They are not done with any respect to African tribal sovereignty or ethnic groups. It's simply matters of real estate convenience. So you see here, the Belgian, the British, the French, the Germans, the Italians, the Portuguese, the Spanish, and by the way, the Danes and the Swedes got in it also. And even the, you say the Austrians, Mozart's country didn't. Well, the Austrians were actually at the conference. They didn't score any land, but what they did score was favorable trading conditions at various ports around the coast of Africa. This again, is it not a form of control? It is a way in which we see both the incredible genius side of the European temperament and then sadly, its darker side as well. And I feel very much that the music tells us that these two are related. Now, it's a whole different lesson to talk about, well, did Beethoven know about this? Did Frescobaldi know about it? I mean, did they know about this? That's a whole other issue, which we'll talk about another time. But I want to actually finish up with two composers who really would not fit into this colonialist mentality, one being Gustav Mahler and the other being Jurgi Ligeti. Let's look first at Mahler. I can't resist showing you a brief picture of a photo that I took. This is the composing hut where Mahler composed the Sixth Symphony, whose first movement we're going to listen to in just a moment. I was living in Europe, and I was on a total Mahler tear. I lived, breathed, slept, and dreamt Mahler. And I had read that there was a composing hut behind this house in Meiernig, a small town along a lake, a beautiful lake called the Wörthersee, in Austria, where Mahler would go in the summertime when he wasn't conducting to do his main composing. And I wanted to go find it. Well, first I had to find the house. That's a whole other story. We'll save for another MITA lesson. But when I went to go behind the house, there was a little road behind it where people drove and had their driveways. But it was sheer forest in front of me, just trees and underbrush. There was no way backward there. And I thought, that's kind of funny. I mean, the book is pretty clear about Mahler's composing hut being behind the house. So anyway, I went into town, I took a bus, and I bought a machete. And for 4, 5, maybe 6 hours, I began to cut carefully, and I hacked through the underbrush, and at one point I finally came out on this path that led to Mahler's composing hut. Why wasn't it being looked at or observed or a museum? It's because in 1907, his eldest daughter, Maria, died suddenly of scarlet fever and diphtheria, and Mahler packed up the family. They left. He never returned here. So this hut where I had stumbled upon had not been seen in 70 years. I did make a lot of noise about this to friends of mine back in Vienna, very influential people that I knew, and this hut is now today an Austrian landmark. This hut with walls that are a meter thick. Mahler wanted absolute silence when he composed. This piece by Mahler is really quite extraordinary, this sixth symphony. First of all, it's the only symphony of Mahler that ends tragically. The rest of them have some kind of redemptive feature, often of a Christian nature. But this one begins and really ends tragically. But it's also one which is a premonition of war, of the war that would come only a dozen years later. So here is the beginning of it. And you'll hear this is definitely the marching boots of a very large army up to no good. To help us orient ourselves, I'm going to take us back to the listening guide. And in MITA, you can go back and forth to these things very, very quickly. Here's that same opening, this march theme. And then there are a couple of other very contrasting motives. One's called the fate motive. And you'll hear this timpani stroke, dum, dum, da-dum, dum, dum. And it's followed by this chorale theme, which conjures up images of a spiritual world. But the theme that really is a counterpoint to this march theme is a theme that Mahler ran excitedly back for a lunch in 1903 to his wife, Alma, and said, "I've written a theme for you," and it's going into the symphony. And here it is. That's kind of romantic. I'd love to have that theme written for me by somebody, wouldn't you? But what he didn't tell her was that his march theme, his ominous, menacing march theme, has a segment which is exactly like one in Alma's theme. You're going to listen for dee da 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 dum da dum, okay? Dee da dum da dum. Here it is, first in the march theme. It's after several notes, but you'll unmistakably hear it. Now let's listen to Alma's theme. The first couple of notes are soaring notes that are going up to a high climax. But now listen to what happens here. Remember that idea? Dum, da, 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 dum, da, da, dum. It's exactly the same rhythm. Oh my God, the march theme and the love theme are intermixed in Mahler's mind. Freud would have a holiday with this. Well, let's see what happens in the development section. He treats these ideas in a somewhat ominous fashion. Snare drum. That's pretty dark, isn't it? And now Alma's theme, which will have these raucous kind of bleating sounds like a sheep. Listen to this. So all the way throughout, these two themes are played in counterpoint with one another. It is not until the very conclusion of this, and I'm going to take us to the last frame, in which only one of two things can happen if you're Mahler the composer. Alma's love theme can subsume the menacing march and we have a love feast at the end, or the menacing march can subsume Alma's love theme and she will be caught up and swept up in this wave. And of course, it's the latter that happens. Let's listen to how this works. Sure. So we just heard that idea in about five or six different incarnations. Mahler wants to extract every possible ounce of drama and theater and meaning from it. So I think we'll all agree that Alma has been transformed into a march, but Mahler gives us one last feel of the original Alma love theme. It's like a punch in the gut, right? Here we have this big Beethovenian buildup, and we anticipate this big Beethovenian concluding frame, but instead we get this. Where did we get this idea from? My goodness, that's the motivic DNA shared between the march theme and Alma's theme. And in a movement full of ironies, this anti-frame conclusion of Mahler's is perhaps the most ironic touch of all. I want to conclude our survey today with a piece by one of my favorite composers, György Ligeti, born in Hungary. And by the way, that welcoming, generous face is exactly how he was in person by all accounts. But if you were born in 1923, there was something of a stern fate awaiting you. Ligeti was sent to a forced labor camp by the puppet Hungarian government. His brother was sent to a German concentration camp. Both of his parents were sent to Auschwitz. And at the end of the war, only Ligeti and his mother survived. Nonetheless, he went right back to the Franz Liszt Academy, got his degree, began teaching there, actually. But in 1956, when the Soviets brutally put down the Hungarian uprising, Ligeti had had enough. So he said to his ex-wife, let's get out of here. And they fled to, of all places, Vienna, one of the seats of the Nazi empire. But they got remarried the next year, and Ligeti embarked on another full half century of an extraordinarily productive compositional life. The piece we're going to look at is one that Ligeti wrote in the mid-1960s. And if you actually saw the film 2001, directed by Stanley Kubrick, then you may already be familiar with it. It's entitled Lux Aeterna, a text that comes at the end of the Requiem Mass. It's simple and direct and profound. Let eternal light shine on them, O Lord, for thou art merciful in eternity. Eternal rest grant to them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine on them. So how does Ligeti set this? Well, it's for soprano, alto, tenor, and bass, but with a twist. The sopranos have four voices themselves, separate ones, four separate alto voices, four separate tenor voices, four separate bass voices, 16 voices in all. So that when even most of them, if not all, are singing together on different pitches, it's a wash of sound not so different from when you go down to the beach and you listen to the waves crashing on the shore. That noise we call white noise because it contains all of the frequencies equally represented. And it's these washes of sound that Ligeti handles so exquisitely in this 9-minute work. But look at these performance directions. The aus der Ferne, from afar. And the directions for the choristers themselves, stets sehr weich einsetzen. All entries very gentle, all entries almost imperceptible. So he has done everything possible to obviate any sense of a distinct frame at the beginning. And even these pitches, here's our favorite note, F, 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 F. It all kind of comes in a delicious blur. And then the first notes that begin the spread of pitches away from this opening F. Let's see how that works. We'll explore this entire work another time, but if you have this kind of imperceptible beginning, how then would you conclude this work? Well, let's look for a moment at the text that I read a little bit earlier. The last line is, "Let perpetual light shine on them." But then Ligeti begins to fragment this line itself. So, "Lux perpetua luceat eis" becomes simply "luceat eis." And finally then, just light, luceat. And then finally just luce. And it dies away. Let's see how Ligeti manages this. All voices now down. Eight voices. Now to just the four alto voices. Singing on F, our initial note, and G. Morendo meaning dying. And finally, niente, to nothing. But then what is this? Seven bars with the chorus silent. And that sound field that we were privileged to be part of for 9 minutes slips back into eternity. And Ligeti wants to make sure both the performers and the audience have a bit of time to grasp that notion completely. Okay, that's a wrap for this week. I really hope that you enjoyed our little highlights tour of visual art and musical frames, and that it's given you a little bit of one of life's greatest gifts, which is food for thought. I also hope that those of you who are considering taking out a MITA subscription understand that the hors d'oeuvres you were served up today in these pieces can be your entrees for life. We'll come up with another interesting angle for next week, and I hope you'll be able to join us. By the way, you can tell your friends and family that we still have a few empty chairs. So long.